Good morning, everyone. We're glad you're here. If you came in and you're planning on participating in communion, but you didn't notice the communion element cups back in the back, you'll want to get up maybe right now and go get those. Okay. I want to call us to worship this morning from Psalm 130. When we get that up on the screen, let's see if you can say it with me. There we are. Would you read this with me? If you, O Lord, kept a record of our sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. Let's pray together. God, if you didn't forgive, what hope would we have? And why would we even be concerned about you? But you have taken the initiative, and you have forgiven our sins through your Son, Jesus Christ. Now we come to you through him to worship, to thank you for all you've done, and praise your great name. Receive our praise, for it's in Christ that we bring it. Amen.
Stand with me as we sing, Come Thou Almighty King.
Come Thou Almighty King, help us Thy name to sing. Help us to praise, Father, all glorious, o'er all victorious. Come and reign over us, Ancient of Days. Come, Thou incarnate Word, gird on Thy mighty sword our prayer. And thy people bless, and give thy word success. Spirit of holiness on us descend. Come, Holy Comforter, thy sacred witness bear in this glad hour. Near from us depart, Spirit of power. To the Great One in three, eternal praises be, hence evermore. His sovereign majesty may we in glory see, and to eternity love and adore.
You may be seated.
I will be reading from the book of Romans, the 8th chapter, verses 14 through 17. Because those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may share in his glory.
I'm going to ask you to stand with me again and sing Grace Greater Than Our Sin.
Marvelous. marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within, grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold threaten the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
You may be seated. This time we're going to have communion, and I'm going to suggest if you walked in, since Shane announced it, if you didn't get one of the cups, they are in the back. Feel free to go get one at this moment. Someone asked me this morning, you know, how did you handle that with your kids? What did that look like with your kids when they were little? And I tried to think about my kids and what they did or what they thought as they sat through communion. And I think even as an adult, many believers don't know what to do with communion. The reason I say that is because most of us are not Jews. Most of us have, in fact, raise your hand if you've sat through a Seder meal. Okay? A few of you, but not many. And the Seder meal gives perspective. I remember reading through 1 Corinthians one time and seeing where they were admonished to not come and be hungry. And I'm like, how could you come hungry with this being expected to be your meal? So it puts perspective there. And one of the greatest perspectives of the Seder meal is that the children are involved throughout the Seder meal, asking questions and things of that nature. What happened and why do we do this? And then the person leading would give answers to what they're doing and why. And so I encourage you this morning, if you don't know why we're doing this, dive into the Word of God to get a greater understanding. But in brief, just like Jesus and the disciples met in that upper room before he was taken and he was crucified, they were remembering what the children of Israel had experienced. They were remembering their captivity. They were remembering the bitterness of that captivity. They were remembering the deliverance that God gave. And one of the most poignant things that they did from that point forward was that they would sacrifice a lamb, the Passover lamb. And so as they would go through the Seder meal, they would get to a point where they would break the bread. And in fact, I didn't realize till I researched some of the Seder meal myself that there were a number of times that they were using that and touching that. And it was a reminder of how they had gone through the Red Sea, how they had had manna, how they had had so many things given to them in a physical way to remind them. And so this morning, we take a small element of that meal to remind us. And I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians 11, where Paul says, I received from the Lord what I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus on that night when he was betrayed took bread. when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And they would break the matzah. What have you in your life seen God do? Breaking the waters for you. Breaking your captivity for you. And the first thing about this is that if you want to take part in this meal, you need to have trusted Jesus as your Savior, breaking you from the slavery of sin. And if you've done that in your life, if you've trusted Jesus Christ, we invite you to take this meal with us. So I invite you, as Jesus had told them, take the bread. He said, "This is my body broken for you." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup, the new covenant in my blood. This do as oft as you drink it." Some people believe that the wine actually turns into blood, and it's not my belief. I believe that just as that Passover meal was a representation and a symbol of what they had experienced, I believe the wine is an example and a symbol of the life we have in Jesus' blood, because we have life in our blood, right? And Jesus' pure, sinless, spotless life gives us eternal life as well. So if you've trusted Christ as your Savior, take the wine, the drink with me. Now that night they rose and they sang a song, and we'll do some more singing in just a minute, but let's just take a moment and thank the Lord in prayer for what he gave us in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for all of the symbolisms and the examples, such as the Passover meal that you gave us. But Lord, not just the symbolisms. We don't want to just celebrate like many celebrate various celebrations because they can and have a long weekend or something like that. But Lord, we want to reverence our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and remember him. And because we remember, we want to live in honor of him. Thank you, Lord, for shedding your blood, for allowing your body to be broken for us, that we can raise our lives in you and worship you with the way we live. In Jesus' name I ask. Amen.
If you're able, would you stand together?
Thank you. as your love goes further still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes, you're the giver of life. You alone can rescue, you alone can save, you alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, led us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise.
Reading from God's Word in the book of John, chapter 14, verses 15 through 18. If you love me, you will obey what I command, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you.
Be seated.
Can I direct your attention to the bulletin panel with the prayer needs on it and ask you to pray for those needs this week? We have some big ones. Would you see how you can help? And part of the way you can help is by praying. So let's pray right now. We're glad, O Lord, that you know what's happening among us. You're not distant. You're not apathetic. You love your people. Our problems, you've taken them on. And they are not problems for you. But Lord, we're small and sometimes overwhelmed. So we ask for your mercy on your people. Would you lift us up, give us strength, hope for the future, and especially confidence in you? Would you bring ways to mind that we can help and love each other? And then energize us so that we can act in ways that are going to build each other up. Pray you'll speak to us this morning by your Spirit. We need to hear from you. We need to see you at work in our lives. And what we pray for us, we pray for every other church of the Lord Jesus that's meeting anywhere around our community and elsewhere. Would you speak your word to your people? It's a great gift. Would you bless them? I ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in Colossians chapter 3 today. We'll be thinking about really the first whole half of that chapter, but I'm going to just read for us verses 12 through 14 right now. This is the Apostle Paul writing, a church that he's never visited. He's never been here. He didn't plant it. It's nearby churches that he planted, and he's heard about it through one of his friends, and he writes them, and he says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone else, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. I spoke on forgiveness a couple of weeks ago, and this is a follow-up. We talked about the life in which forgiveness can flourish. Today we're going to talk about how you actually do it when you've been hurt and offended. When I speak on forgiveness, I know that there are people listening whose families have been torn apart and for whom the miracle of forgiveness is their only hope. I know that there are people listening who have been chained to something ugly from their past, and they haven't been able to get free of it. And their only chance to break that chain is forgiveness. God specializes in forgiveness. He not only forgives us, he transforms us into forgiving people. Once, after Chuck Colson had started Prison Fellowship, he was in Indiana at a state prison. He had the singer-songwriter, somebody Karen and I knew from our college days, Nancy Honeytree, leading songs she was singing. And he stood and watched one of the inmates, a guy named James Brewer, who was just singing out at the top of his lungs. His face was radiant. James Brewer had come to know the Lord Jesus in prison, and his life was being transformed. At the conclusion of that song, the prison fellowship team began shaking hands with people and saying goodbye, and Brewer returned to his cell, this prisoner, but he was walking shoulder to shoulder with one of the prison fellowship volunteers. So Colson had to go and meet the governor in Indianapolis in just 2 hours. And so he followed them and he told the volunteer, "We've got to hurry." And the volunteer said, "Just a minute." And Colson said, "No, I'm sorry, the plane is waiting. We need to go right now." And the volunteer said, "Please, this is important. I'm Judge Clement. I sentenced this man to die. Now he's born again. He's my brother, and we want to pray together." This is what Colson wrote about that. "I stood in the entrance to that solitary, dimly lit cell, frozen in place. Here were two men, one black, one white, one powerful, one powerless, one who had sentenced the other to die. Yet there they stood, grasping a Bible together, Brewer smiling so genuinely, the judge so filled with love for the prisoner at his side. As we're thinking about forgiveness today, we need to know how to do it. We need to know that because some of us have been chained to the past, and forgiveness is the only way we're going to get free. We're not strong enough to break that chain, but God is, and he'll help. He specializes in forgiveness. With his help and in his name, people have performed remarkable acts of forgiveness throughout history. Churches have experienced breakthrough moments when one follower of Jesus has forgiven another. And such acts of forgiveness have gone on to transform entire communities. Families, too, have been transformed from hatred to love, from chaos to peace, by the grace of forgiveness. It is a powerful thing. That sounds wonderful. But as C.S. Lewis pointed out to an English audience during the middle of the Second World War, everybody says that forgiveness is a lovely idea until they have something to forgive. But it's only when we have something to forgive or something that needs to be forgiven that the real wonder of forgiveness emerges. Now, I expect God will speak to some of us this morning. To some of us, he'll say, "You need to seek forgiveness by confession and repentance and restitution." To others, he'll say, "Aren't you tired of lugging that awful chain of resentment around. Haven't you realized you're the prisoner here? As I've forgiven you, you must forgive. Your future hangs on your willingness to forgive. But it's not just your future. It's not only about what will benefit you. It's about living in a community of forgiving love. It's about what Christ has commanded us. It's about God's action in bringing people into his kingdom. If they don't see forgiveness among us, our talk about God's forgiveness will mean nothing to them. But when they see it lived out right in front of them, it is a powerful thing. In June of 1972, I was in high school in June of 1972. And I know what that means. Some of you will say, you are such a kid. And others of you will say, man, is that guy old? I had no idea. In June of 1972, South Vietnamese planes, in conjunction with American military intelligence, dropped napalm bombs on the village of Trang Bang, which had been occupied by North Vietnamese soldiers. What U.S. intelligence missed was that there were South Vietnamese soldiers and civilians hiding in a temple. When the bombing started, they ran. They tried to run towards South Vietnamese lines, but the napalm caught a young girl's clothes on fire. She ripped them off as she ran. At that moment, a photographer named Nick Ut, a Vietnamese-American guy, snapped a picture of that girl, Kim Phuc. Many of you know the picture. And then, many of you, at least I didn't know, that after he took the picture, he took her and other wounded children to an American-funded hospital in Saigon. Doctors there did not expect her to survive. But she did. She spent 14 months in hospital and went through 17 surgeries. The American officer who ordered that attack was a guy named John Plummer. The photo of Kim, which was seen all around the world, it won a Pulitzer Prize, was in the New York Times, and then everyone, if you're old enough, you've seen this picture. He saw that picture and it haunted him. He looked at it, he couldn't stop looking at it until he could see her face with his eyes closed. And the pain and the fear that was in her eyes welled up in his heart. His guilt was so great, he was almost overwhelmed by it. Years later, John Plummer became a Christian. And he felt that he was called by God to serve the church. He attended seminary and entered pastoral ministry. In 1996, which was about the time I think he entered the pastorate, he was at a military reunion where he talked to a man who knew both Kim, that girl, Kim Phuc, and Nick Ut, the photographer. And the man told him that two of Kim's cousins were killed in that bombing. And he told him how, he described how Nick, the photographer, poured water from his canteen on Kim's burns. Told him about the 14 months in hospital, the 17 plastic surgeries. He said that Kim had moved from Vietnam to Canada and was now living in Toronto. That same year, 1996, Kim was invited to speak at the Vietnam Veterans Memorial in Washington, D.C. When Plummer heard that, he knew he needed to be there. During her speech, she said this: "If I ever were to meet the pilot of that plane, I would tell him that I forgive him and that we can't change the past, but I hope we can work together to change the future." So Plummer's sitting there listening to this, and afterwards he sends a note asking if he can meet her. When he saw her, all he could say was, "I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry." And she said, "It's all right, it's all right. I forgive, I forgive." By the way, Kim Phuc became a believer in Jesus in 1982. As we saw a couple weeks ago, forgiveness is possible in a certain kind of life and impossible in other kinds of life. Some people think that they can simply choose to forgive whenever they want to. The problem is that they never want to. We think we can stay the same and yet extend forgiveness when we choose. It doesn't work that way. Paul understood this, and before he tells the Colossians in verse 13, chapter 3, verse 13, to forgive, he gives them a picture of the kind of life in which that's possible. It's a life, as he makes clear in the first few verses, that is all wrapped up in Jesus. Notice the phrase in verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, appears. Christ, who is our life, it's because he is our life that we can forgive. People who want to be able to forgive, but who don't want to go overboard on all this religion stuff, are just fooling themselves. It's a life that has dealt decisively and deals appropriately with the destructive attitudes and behaviors that have been part of us. So this is verse 8. Rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. You will not succeed. You cannot succeed as a forgiving person while holding on to attitudes of anger and malice. People who think they can forgive without changing are living in a fantasy world. To be able to forgive, we must replace anger and resentment with love and blessing. Look at verse 12. Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. The act of forgiveness can't be isolated from the attitudes of compassion, kindness, and humility. Compassion, kindness, and humility is the soil mix in which the seed of forgiveness grows. It dies in the soil of anger and malice and gossip. Right here is where so many of us fail. We expect to remain the same, which frankly is proud and self-righteous, and yet be able to forgive. And it doesn't work that way. Now notice what Paul says in verse 13. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. Now note the distinction between bearing with and forgiving. We bear with annoyances, with personal idiosyncrasies, with personality differences, but we forgive sins. Note, too, that our forgiveness is modeled on God's forgiveness. We forgive others as the Lord forgave us. That is a repeated theme in the New Testament. Jesus speaks of it. Paul speaks of it. In Ephesians, he writes, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. So that just begs us to ask this question: how did God forgive us? Let me give you a couple of things. If you're saying, I want to forgive, this is how you do it. First, God forgives all our sins, which is to say, no sin is so great as to fall outside the scope of God's forgiveness. In the previous chapter, Paul wrote, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, not just the minor ones. He doesn't have a category that says, this one is okay, but that one's not. Forgiving as God forgives means that we can never say, I can forgive everything but that. People who say such things think that small sins are in the province of forgiveness, but big ones are not. They're willing to forgive irritations and annoyances, but remember, we don't forgive those things. We bear with them. We forgive sin. God takes sin seriously. Sometimes we can think, if you forgive sin, that means you don't take it serious. No, that's just the opposite. God never says, hey, forget it, it's no big deal. He sends his son to die for sin so that we might be forgiven. It's a big deal. When you forgive someone, you're saying it doesn't matter. You're not saying that. You're saying it matters enough to warrant the radical and costly act of forgiveness. Next, God forgives, not because of who we are, but because of who He is. Not because we deserve it, but because He is the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and abounding in love, forgiving the sins of thousands. Some people think they can't forgive until the offender proves worthy of it. I'm waiting to see. But, and this is critical to understand, sin never deserves forgiveness. God doesn't forgive us because we deserve it. He, as David put it, does not treat us as our sins deserve. We don't forgive people because they merit forgiveness. We forgive them because we belong to Jesus Christ. We forgive because God has forgiven us. Now, here's another thing about how God forgives. He does it graciously. The word that we have translated forgive here is a Greek word, charizomai. Charizomai comes from the word group charis, which means grace. In Romans 8:32, we find this same exact word used where Paul says, will he not graciously give us all things? The idea here is to grace people with forgiveness. Grace and gracefulness always go together. When I was in Mexico recently, I spoke to the Spectrum volunteers. Matt Cooey asked me, would you do a Bible study for us? And I said, what are people's needs here? He said, we need to understand grace. We really don't get grace. And one of the things that means is that often in Mexican churches, pastors berate people. Tell them to straighten up. You need to live better. You're not doing it. But grace is always gracious. Some people are not. They forgive us in such a way that we wish we'd never been forgiven. They remind us of what we've done, remind us of the pain that they've suffered. They remind other people of what we've done. That is not God's way. He says, "For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more." If we forgive as we've been forgiven, we'll be gracious to people. We'll not intentionally recall their sins. We will certainly be careful not to talk about them to other people. The year Karen and I got married, Penn State played Alabama in the Sugar Bowl. Penn State was ranked number one in the nation. Alabama was ranked number two, so they're playing for the national championship. Alabama was up by a touchdown. It's 14-7. There's 6 minutes left, but they were stuck deep in their own territory, right up against their goal line, and they had to punt. The center muffed the snap, and it bounced off the turf. The punter picked it up and tried to kick it as quickly as he could, but it didn't go very far. It went out of bounds at about the 30-yard line. So here's Penn State with the ball, close to the red zone, ready to score again. But the play got called back. There was a flag on the play because an Alabama player, or I'm sorry, a Penn State had too many players on the field. Someone had either run on when he wasn't supposed to, or had run off, or didn't run off when he was supposed to. So after the game, that probably, or it possibly cost Penn State the national championship, that one mistake. After the game, a reporter asked the Penn State coach who the player was that had potentially lost the game for them. And this is what he said. It's only a game. I have no intention of ever revealing that boy's name. He just made a mistake. Graciousness characterizes forgiveness. It characterizes God. And it ought to characterize us. One more thing about God's forgiveness. When he says, I will remember your sins no more, that does not mean he can't remember them. It means he chooses not to. Many people think that they must have done something wrong. I tried to forgive, but I just can't forget what's happened. So I must have done it wrong. Anger wells up inside every time I see that person. And if I'd truly forgiven, wouldn't the memory be gone? Wouldn't the pain be gone? But forgiveness does not cause forgetfulness, nor does it immediately relieve us of pain. If you've ever had surgery, you know what I mean. The pain continues, and sometimes it gets even worse with the surgery for a while. But the surgeons removed the underlying cause, and that will, in time, take away the pain, as long as we don't pick at the incision site and cause infection. And it's just that way when you forgive. The pain will be there until time and the rising life of the Spirit cause it to fade. But by forgiving it, we've already dealt with the underlying cause. Now we need to learn not to take it up again and again. We must resist the urge to pick at the incision site. I've heard people say, well, I forgive as a Christian, but I won't forget. That is not forgiving as a Christian. It's certainly not forgiving as the Lord forgave you. Not being willing to forget is a far cry from not being able to forget. Now I have to ask, is God speaking to you about forgiving in some particular way? And are you wondering what you should do next? I want to make some suggestions. Start by telling God that you're willing to forgive the person who's hurt you. I know for some people that is really scary. And we may need to talk further about this because there's much more that you need to understand. But would you start by saying to God, I'm willing, or at least I'm willing to be made willing to forgive. Ask him for his help. You're going to need it. You're going to need to pray your way through this. Next, make up your mind, I am not going to use the offender's sin against them. I'm not going to do that. That means don't gossip about them, don't color other people's thinking about them, and don't even allow yourself to rehearse their sin against you in your mind. Now, you'll find yourself doing that, and you'll have to say, no, I'm not going to do that. And 15 seconds later, you'll find yourself doing it again. And you'll have to say it again. You know, follow. I learned something years ago. I read it, and I've used it, and it always works. I shouldn't say always works. It almost always works. It's called the rule of three no's. So, if you know, before we had caller ID, we get nonstop calls from people who are trying to sell us stuff, right? And if you tell them no, what do? They just switch gears and keep going, right? And you tell them no again, and they switch gears, and they keep going. And then you tell them no a third time, and they give up. You have to do that with yourself. You have to keep saying, no, I will not do this. You choose again and again not to do it. Stop doing the math in your head. Do you know what I mean? The kind of math where you add up all the things that you did right and all the things that they did wrong. You keep a balance sheet. Throw away the balance sheet. And then if it's the loving thing to do, tell the person of your decision to forgive. Tell them, I forgive you. I say if it's the loving thing to do. Sometimes it's not. If the other person doesn't know of the offense, If the relationship hasn't been severed, if telling that person will hurt them or others, I've seen this happen. I need to go and confess my sin of adultery from years ago, and that person's now married and has children or whatever. You have to pray through this and find out whether you're just getting this off your chest or if you are bringing love and reconciliation. If you are, then you need to go to that person and say, I forgive you. If you're not, just agree with God to forgive. Next, don't only forgive the person. And this is the thing I think we miss all the time. Don't only forgive the person for the act they committed, but for the consequences that followed that action. That's usually where the hurt resides. If you don't include that in the forgiveness, you're going to feel that things are undone. It'll keep bothering you. Now, once you've made the choice to forgive, don't be surprised if you become even more aware of the damage and pain that the offenses caused you. The offender may come to mind more than ever. If that happens, here's what to do. Every time the offender comes to mind, pray for him or her. Jesus told us specifically to bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. Nothing is more effective at relieving the pain than a closely followed regimen of prayer for the person you've forgiven. The community of the forgiven is the community of the forgiving. Remember the prayer that Jesus taught us. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. If you say, but I can still go to heaven even if I don't forgive, I say, that is not the spirit of the one who left heaven to bring forgiveness. Forgiveness is in our DNA if we're Christ's people. It's who we are. It's what life in the company of the forgiven entails. Forgiven and forgiving. God has joined the two together. What God has joined together, let no one put asunder. All right, let's pray. I'm going to give you a minute. Maybe you need to talk to God. Maybe God's been speaking to you by his Spirit in this. If so, would you tell him that you're willing to forgive? And if he's speaking to you about the need to seek forgiveness, would you tell him that you'll do it? Lord, I am filled with gratitude, and I think many of us are, for your forgiveness for us. We not only don't deserve it, we could never deserve it. But I go further and ask you to make us a forgiving people from our hearts. Free us from the chains that have bound us. And do it for the sake of your Son, Jesus, whom we love. Amen.
Would you stand with us and sing? This will be a new song for us.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life. how strange and divine. I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side, the Savior, he will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need his power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know he will renew me until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory.
Just a few announcements before we go. There is a little booklet out by the CDs. The CDs for the sermon CDs are right to the right of the exit as you're going out to the parking lot. So there's a table right there with CDs on it. And these little booklets on forgiveness, they go into some of the things we didn't have time to talk about today. I'd encourage you to pick one up. If this is something that you think, I need to know more about that, grab one of those. In your bulletin, I'll mention just a few things. Graduation Sunday is next Sunday, and so our seniors are going to be here in the 11 o'clock service, and we want to recognize them. Maybe you can come in to that service next week, celebrate with our seniors who are graduating. Senior High is going to have their Follow Me Week on July 10th through the 14th. Follow Me Week is a unique thing at Lockwood. It's a great thing for helping people develop their discipleship to Jesus. So that's exciting. You can pray for that. And if you have senior hires who are interested, have them call Kevin. His phone number's in the bulletin. There is a service this afternoon at 5 p.m. out at Northview Christian Church. with many other churches who've been part of the Bold Faith Initiative this time around. If you'd like to join us, that would be great. We'll be there at 5 and the bowl out behind the church. So come early enough, bring a lawn chair or something to sit on, and we'll share together and hear other Christians' testimonies. And maybe you have a story that you want to share, maybe something that's come from wearing one of these bracelets and you've had the opportunity to talk with someone else about the Lord. From the bracelet, you can share that. Tonight, 5 o'clock. I'm excited about what's happening. Our deacons are visiting families who aren't able to make it to church. And folks who aren't on the deacon team can join them and go with them. And that's really cool. So my son and his 7-year-old grandson are going to go visit one of our 95-year-old folks and spend a little time with them and with her and, you know, just pray with her and just let her know that we love her. And that could be something you could do, too. And if you're interested, would you call Seth Butters? His number is in the bulletin. Call him or text him. Let him know you're interested. The Lockwood Ladies Annual Picnic is always a lot of fun. It's going to be at Karen Justice's home this year. That's on the 28th at 6:30. If you want to be a part of that, would you mark it on the tear-off? And there are other things on the tear-off. You can read them, put your mark there. Make sure you include your name, set it in the offering plate before you leave. Back on that table where the offering plates are, there are 2 cafe tables in the back of the room, you'll find Go Deep sheets that will help you think through this passage in Colossians and apply it to your own life. I'd encourage you to pick one up, take it with you, and do that during the week. So a 25-minute sermon, that's great, but in 25 minutes from now, you're going to be thinking about totally other things, and that just is a help to say, I don't want to just walk out and do nothing. I want to actually put it into practice. There are also offering plates there. If you have an offering, you can place the offering in the plate as you leave. I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and we'll be dismissed. Let's pray. Lord, may you receive honor and glory through our lives. May people see that we are who we are because you are who you are. And by your grace, may that include, may they see us as forgiving people. Help us with this. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now, to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, we'll have prayer helpers right over here. If you have a prayer need in your life, come on up, and they'd be happy to pray with you.